stay in a spot where your brother was, because then you'd be talking about culture. At the same time this was going on, the Indian Act was imposed. Anybody know the ins and outs of the Indian Act? This was five generations ago, not that much time. Not allowed to speak any native language. Not allowed to wear any ceremonial garb. Not allowed to practice any ceremony. Not allowed to talk your language. Not allowed to talk about your language. Or you're going to jail. That was the Indian Act. That was going on while missionaries are going to communities and taking children. They have since been fairly nice in some of the verbiage, but make no mistake, their verbiage then was kill the Indian, save the child. Rob them of all culture, all knowledge, and fully Europeanize them. There's a problem. By the way, what they found in hindsight was 40% of the staff wasn't even trained teachers. They're just missionaries. A problem ensues. And I'm going to tell you guys this as graphically as possible. And I'll apologize in advance for that. But we have people who maybe shouldn't have had those positions of trust. And they're telling young children, I'm abusing you because I love you. I'm sexually abusing you because I love you. This is why we're doing this. We have, when I talk about malnutrition, this isn't BS. This is where a lot of science came from to find out what happens to children, to growing bodies, when they endure malnutrition. A lot of that research came from residential schools intentionally starving children to see what happened to a growing body during malnutrition. They're learning a language they never knew. Their culture is totally robbed from them. Up till that point in time, a lot of people would talk about, you know, paternal stuff and hereditary peeps and all that kind of stuff. Back when this was happening, what role do you think women played in our communities? I mean, we all know the life giver role, right? We all understand what that is. Anybody else know? They're the leaders. They're the strategists. Women were respected to the utmost, never abused. That wasn't in our culture. When we had tough decisions, when we had strategy, it was women making those decisions. When they imposed the Indian Act, it was imposed because they had no other way to rob the women of their leadership roles and identity. Imposing the Indian Act did that in a heartbeat. And every community we had suddenly lost a massive amount of leadership and strategy and thought power because the women that we had as leaders were no longer able to lead in any way without going to jail. Yes, we had male chiefs, doesn't matter. We had female strategists. Our liaisons, when we would expand, were always females. respected and worshipped to the utmost. So there was nothing like domestic violence then. There was nothing like child abuse. And by the way, for those kind of things, when a young couple would have a problem, the elders would take them into a teepee with their parents from each family and the two people. That's where they'd work out their problems. They'd have one meeting, and the elders and the parents would tell them who was doing what wrong, how it should be done right, and things would proceed, and it was corrected. We have the Indian Act going. We have residential schools going. What else do we have? Bonus question. What's the next trifecta? What makes the trifecta? Alcohol being poured into our communities like crazy. Did we have alcohol before European colonization? Yeah, we did. We knew how to make mash out of venison, but only for medicinal purposes. Only our medicine men, etc., knew how to use it. We didn't abuse it in any way or anything else. Funny thing is, we have all of this happening. Okay. Forget about that as it's happening. What I want to bring you forward to is now, what about those kids that are graduating? By the way, 150,000 indigenous people finish residential schools. I say finish because they didn't count when you're going in. They only counted on the way out. Make accounting easier. So we have alcohol pouring in. We have people coming out of these residential schools. They don't speak our language anymore.
They don't speak Cree, they don't speak Ojibwe, they speak English.
And they're being sent back to their communities. How many people in their communities do you think are speaking English at that point in time? Not that damn many. And they know nothing of their culture, but that's where they've been sent back to remote seclusion. Because if you take all our cultural value away, it really is just remote seclusion. So, right? Thank you. Do the drop mic with this. Honestly, that's we have people going back to the community that are angry and that have access to alcohol and have spent most of their child lives being sexually abused and told, I'm doing it because I love you. So alcohol finds their way into that pain pretty fast. That's great. Now we have alcoholics struggling, people struggling with addiction that have had massive amounts of abuse bestowed upon them and complete alienation and isolation from their community. My parents and grandparents, for some of you, your parents, for some of you, your great-grandparents now, I guess, because some of you are kind of young. Well, those people did some, if you're raised, every time you're sexually abused, it's done because somebody loves you, and you didn't receive any other education, and you make a family, how are you going to show your kids you love them? I'm not trying to make bad people good, don't get me wrong. People are accountable for their own things and I expect that all the way. However, that's kind of a crippling blow from a cultural standpoint. You think of a generation going to residential schools, I want you to understand something else. That means there's a generation that never got up to elders. Didn't have any traditional knowledge of becoming elders. So here, in what I like to call the Cree lands, it isn't so bad. We have a lot of our culture still taught and preserved, and it's very valuable, and we should hold on to it. Ojibwe's down east were destroyed, right? We just started getting our written language back up to, I think we have 10,000 words in our dictionary now. Most of our teaching's gone. When we actually started doing discoveries in our communities, sexual abuse was up around the 85% mark, and most of it incest. Alcoholism was in the high 80s. We didn't have any elders left. The Ojibwe nations down east almost collapsed. You know what we had to do? We had to call Cree people. We had to call Cree elders from Woodlands to go down east to teach the elders teachings and how to be elders again, how to be guidance, people of spiritual guidance. So if you ever wonder what kind of regard Ojibwe's keep Cree in, keep that in mind, that Cree are celebrated as the knowledge keepers for most tribes across North America because of how well the records have been orally maintained over the years. So that would lend itself to a lot of generations of dysfunction, right? Now, let's think about this on a little bit of a broader scale. And say, okay, so we understand that people are coming back, they're going to be a little bit damaged. Mm-hmm. And they're going to be our parents, and our uncles and our aunties. And those are going to be our role models. Remember this morning talking about kids and role models? You don't get to pick whether your kid has a good one or a bad one, it's just all the adults present are that child's role models. So that's kind of where we grow up. Well, I'm not going to speak on anybody else's behalf, but I can speak on mine. I grew up with piles of alcohol. In fact, that seemed to me to be what men did. We drank, and we fought. That's the long and short of it. So, and we picked up girls. So, I got my first drink when I was about 9, by the way, my uncle. I used to have an uncle that would come over to the house when all the partying was done. He'd come over early in the morning, and he'd use this little metal strainer, and he'd hold it over a glass and go get all the beer bottles, and pour them through the strainer into the glass so that the strainer would catch all the cigarette butts and stuff. And then that'd be his beer. That was my first taste of beer. I was nine, I got up early to watch Saturday morning cartoons, and Michael Chuck said, "Here, this'll make a man out of you." I was so thrilled to be a man, honestly. Well, a couple years later, wasn't too far anyways, I thought I was a man. By 12 or 13, I was a man because I could pick up women, I could drink like a fish, and I could beat the piss out of anybody standing in front of me. So I must be a great man. Yeah. Nobody stepped in when I was 18 and said, "This is a lesson on how to be an indigenous man." Hell, this is a lesson on how to be a productive man. I don't think girls got any either. I mean, I didn't exactly stare at mailboxes, but I don't think any girls got any manuals for how to be grown up, how to do all that. Nobody explained that stuff to us. So what we got for lessons were a little bit different and a little bit dysfunctional. And not all of us, some of us. We learned to keep secrets. You know, on behalf of my gender, I apologize, but women of our culture learn to keep secrets deep and tight. That lends itself to anger. Just when you think you're watching your family endure because you fell in love with the wrong person. Would have been great if the adult fairy would have came along and given us all books on how we should be as adults and the right way to be, but we didn't really get that. We learned in kind of a broken way. To say that doesn't generate a lot of alcoholism, a lot of pain, a lot of suffering, and a whole lot of anger